Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to our Everything Parkinson's webinar. We're December. We made it through 2023. Exciting. We've had a whole year of learning. We've had a whole year of expanded knowledge for sure, both about the Parkinson's and everything that surrounds it, including caregiving, including exercise, lifestyle, recommendations. So it's been an exciting year for our webinar. I just wanted to remind everyone of the changes that you might have noticed when we sent the emails last month. We are going to move from a monthly webinar to every 2 months. So we won't have any Everything Parkinson's webinar in January, but we will resume in February. So it's going to be alternating every other month. It's still going to be the first Monday of the month from 12 noon to 1 o'clock p.m. Unless it falls on a holiday, then we move it to the next Monday. Today, last month of the year, we have our always very special speaker in our Everything Parkinson's webinar. She is definitely not new to our webinar, and in fact, probably one of our solid speakers that we have. Without further ado, the captain of our ship, for sure, from here in our Pacific Movement Disorder Center, Dr. Melita Petrossian.
Thank you, Giselle. Thank you. Happy Monday, everybody. I am sipping tea here because my voice is a little bit affected, so I apologize if I get gravelly as we go. I'll try my best. Oh, and let me turn on my subtitles. Okay, did that work? There we go. Okay, so we're going to be discussing some challenges that people can experience with communication, cognitive changes, and coping strategies. And this is not so much an outline as it will all sort of be intermixed. I always like to start with a caveat that not all patients will experience all of these symptoms either now or in the future. So please don't be alarmed by what you might come across, but just sort of take it as learning opportunities. So I always like to give people the analogy that Parkinson's affects the autopilot of the brain when it comes to controlling movement. So for example, shuffling gait, stooped posture, reduced arm swing, reduced facial expressivity, softer quality of the voice. All of that is because Parkinson's affects those signals that are coming through to control automatic movements. However, it goes beyond just the motor symptoms as well as non-motor, meaning cognitive symptoms also, or that is to say cognitive tasks also rely on an autopilot. So for example, planning where you're going to go get your groceries from and go home from there and planning that route, those kinds of things, all of that is really on autopilot most of the time, and that cognitive autopilot is affected. There's a really important emotional contributor in general, but even more so in Parkinson's, where states of anxiety, depression, or feeling stressed or pressured affect the physical functioning, which can then affect cognitive. And so this can go in a kind of cyclical way. And I apologize because I realize that I'm missing three other arrows here, which is that it can go the other way as well. Physical symptoms can cause emotional symptoms. Cognitive symptoms can cause physical symptoms. So it can go in all directions. So I'm going to be referencing a book today called Detours Through the Parkinsonian Brain. The illustrations you'll see are done by Marina Neur de Graaf, who wrote the book. She's a woman who had Parkinson's disease. And she wrote the book in collaboration with a very well-known Parkinson's neurologist, as well as a neuropsychologist. And she really describes compensatory strategies for thinking obstacles. The book is available at the website you see there for purchase, but it's also available as a free PDF from the second website, zenota.org, because the authors wanted to make sure that the opportunity for improving quality of life was available to all. But the analogy, I think, is very apt. This idea of an obstacle or a roadblock occurring, and again, it can occur physically as well, but today's talk is going to be more focused on the cognitive symptoms and the idea of needing to find a detour. So the concept would be, if you're on a journey going to a destination such as your home, and the road is closed that you would normally take, you're not going to just stop where you are and decide that you're not going to live at home anymore. You're going to have to find a way to get home. And that way home is a detour. And that detour may take longer to get home. It may be frustrating to go a different direction, and it may require creativity. But you will get there in the end. And I think that that analogy, you know, puts people at ease to kind of discover those detours, because then they can sort of regain confidence that they will get there cognitively. It just might look a little bit different. So we'll go through some examples of what people might experience and what the potential detour options might be. So for example, a lot of people with Parkinson's may have difficulty filtering visual and auditory stimuli that might manifest as trouble focusing on the task at hand, or trouble ignoring irrelevant sounds such as background conversations, or if the TV is on or the coffee grinder gets turned on. And so people may have difficulty with larger gatherings because of that. So some options might include having gatherings with smaller groups, attending events for shorter periods of time. If somebody is trying to work, they may need to wear noise-canceling headphones if there's a lot of stimuli around. But sometimes people need to advocate for themselves and or for their loved one with Parkinson's and say, please, may we turn off the radio or TV? Or could you please talk one at a time? And the way the authors of the book visualized what those requests might look like is in these little cards that can be handed out to, you know, friends and acquaintances, where, you know, if you know, people want to sort of engage with the, you know, requests that will help the person with Parkinson's do better at that event, for example, or if they may feel, you know, difficulty expressing that, might be easier to hand a card over. And those cards are available to be downloaded through that website as well. And again, the idea is that, you know, you find a way to make things work. Another obstacle that can occur is difficulty with concentration, difficulty sustaining attention. And remember that attention is the building block for memory. So if we are not paying attention, we are not going to make that memory. That memory can never be retrieved if it wasn't made in the first place. So for example, you know, if somebody is trying to read a book, which is a long book, they may feel that they'll do better by reading for shorter periods of time, or reading a short story instead of a long book. If they're going through their morning and they find that they're losing focus of, wait, what did I come into this room for? There was something I needed from this room. Having a spoken monologue can help. For example, okay, I'm going to go to the kitchen. I'm going to get a glass of water. Then I'm going to feed the dog. And as they're walking, they may say that, you know, kitchen, water, dog, you know, so that they remember those key words. Often it's important to make notes. For example, you know, if a you know, if somebody's lecturing, like right now, making a brief note to kind of remember a question or remember a key topic. Sometimes when somebody's having difficulty concentrating on a task, like a computer-based task, they may need to temporarily pause, walk away, retry at a different time. Often incorporating the physical can help, like a stretch, a stand, a couple of, 1 minute of a walk can help sort of jog the memory, as it were. There's a reason for that phrase, jogging the memory. And again, in this case, we're talking about concentration. Another symptom that can occur is difficulty with what we call set shifting. So set shifting refers to a set would be like a cognitive task that's given by a neuropsychologist, and then they give a different task with a different rule. And then that person is asked to shift between those rules. And that shifting between those sets can be very difficult. So how that manifests in real life might be difficulty changing gears, difficulty handling a change in a routine or in plans, freezing when things are different than expected. So how might we handle this? Well, as prepared as we can be for, different things that may come up, that would be one way to do that. Sometimes if somebody is freezing in the moment of the challenge, taking a breath so anxiety clears is important. And again, that's true of almost any obstacle, right? Or, any physical, literal obstacle, of needing to find a detour. Panicking is going to make it harder to find that route. So just taking a breath often really helps people. Sometimes it actually helps to explain to the person that they're with what is happening. I'm feeling a little stuck. Give me a moment so I can shift gears here. Take a short break. Make a joke of it. Sometimes it's important to accept that things are going to be difficult to switch gears. Let's try to make sure we can do things in a more routine way rather than living as spontaneously as one once did. Another very common symptom that comes up often in communication issues is difficulty with word finding. What was that word I was thinking of? It's on the tip of my tongue. What's the name of that one guy from that place that one time? And substituting words with other words. Now, this, of course, is something that can happen to anybody, isn't necessarily specific to Parkinson's, but might be more common in people with Parkinson's. And so how do we cope with this? Well, we might prepare for important conversation with talking points. For example, if you're going to have a phone call with the cable company, making sure that the points that you're trying to make are written out. If you're having an important conversation with a physician, make sure your questions are written out in advance if necessary. Sometimes it helps to visualize the word by seeing the object in your mind. Often it helps to make a joke about it. Often, again, it helps to sort of take a beat, take a rest, take a breath, and trust that that word will come back, restart again. That often makes a big hit. That's that idea of that control alt delete. If you guys are familiar with that from the computer, of having to restart the computer or reboot the computer. Okay, if I just sort of, close out and then try again, the computer will work again if it's sort of glitched for a moment. And people that you're with may accept this and understand this by kind of that same analogy of that computer freezing for a moment. Sometimes it helps to Google it. What was that name of that one guy? Well, Google can help for that. I also like to let care partners know, family members, people like to be helpful. So I see a lot of times the family member is trying to give that word that that person has forgotten. And sometimes that can frustrate the person with Parkinson's because they didn't want the help. They just needed that extra minute or moment, not necessarily minute, but moment. And sometimes it's frustrating to the person with Parkinson's because, no, that wasn't the word they were thinking of. And now that you've come in with the word you thought they were thinking of, they've completely derailed from the actual word or the actual, like, where they were going with that conversation. And that train of thought has been derailed. So often it's better not to say anything and better to just give it a moment, give it a rest. And yet sometimes people will need that help completing that sentence. So I like for people to sort of make an agreement in advance, like, okay, if I look to you or nod or give you a signal, you'll know that I am actually asking you to help me complete this sentence or help me with this thought that I was trying to get across. Trouble finding things can be a common symptom, again, in general, but also more with Parkinson's. People may have difficulty with spatial orientation because they are having difficulty linking that experience, that memory to a place and time. So therefore, then in order to figure out where or when something is or was, it's an extra step that's sometimes harder to get to. So that can cause trouble with retrieving that memory of the spatial information. So an example would be, where did I leave my keys? Where did I put my phone? Where did I put that important piece of information? So how can we cope with this? Well, it can help to simplify things. Limit the number of storage spaces. If you're constantly sort of trying to figure out which jacket pocket is your phone in or your wallet, maybe sew some of those jacket pockets closed. You know, make sure that things are automated. They're always put in a fixed place. What you see here on the picture here is a way to visualize it. Draw the outline of the items needed to leave the house on a tray. Now, this is written in Dutch because this is from the book, but the same concept holds, that you've sort of a picture of, you know, this is where my keys are going to go. This is where my glasses are going to go. This is where my phone is going to go. And it's always going to go to the same spot. And I have a picture of it before I leave the house. When putting something away, say something about that. You know, I put the, you know, hats upstairs on the third shelf, you know, kind of try to say it out loud, try to strengthen that imprint when putting something away so that you're creating more of a memory. If it's something that's going to be used rarely, I do this myself. I write it down. You know, I have certain things that I might need, you know, seasonally. And I know it's going to be hard to find because it's something small. And I literally put a note in my, you know, my cell phone. This is where the blah, blah, blah is kept, so I can find it and not drive myself nuts in the future. Or, you know, what's in the silver suitcase, you know, blah, blah, blah list of things, so that I'm not running around looking for that. Sometimes it helps to make copies of things, you know, have an extra set of keys, have duplications of medications, although that can get a little dicey with taking the meds correctly. So that might work for some, might not work for others. And then what you see on the bottom left picture is something called a tile. A tile is essentially a sensor that links an item to your phone. So for example, the most obvious thing to put it on is your keys. So when you need to find it, you can open the app on your phone and call or sort of ping the keys so that you can listen for where they are. And if you've left it somewhere else, the tile will tell you the last place that this was found. I also, you know, use technology to ping my phone so that I can find it when I've left it somewhere in the house by using a smartwatch. So that's my secret for knowing where my phone is kept. A very common symptom of Parkinson's is trouble getting started. Starting and stopping are hard in Parkinson's, again, both physically and sort of with energy, will, motivation. You know, sometimes we might sacrifice speed for accuracy and vice versa. One example this person gave in the book is they had envisioned trimming the shrubs. They knew they needed to do it. And sort of in their mind, they had trimmed the shrubs 20 times, but they'd never actually done it. They are not that year, what have you. Like they'd sort of not gotten around to it. And so another analogy I always like to give here on the right, that's not a detour, that's just sort of a picture of what the trouble is with getting started. So this is really coming from chemistry. So there's a certain amount of energy that chemical reactions require. Once that chemical reaction has started, it's much easier to keep it going and continue going. But when it hasn't started yet, there's sort of this very difficult, what's called activation energy. And that is almost like a wall that's put up. And that can be a good analogy for what it feels like cognitively, emotionally, physically, especially if it's a task that isn't that fun, you know, like, oh, let's go trim the hedges now. Like, oh my God, like, oh God, this just sounds so overwhelming. I just don't feel like it. Maybe I'll just watch another episode of blah, 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 and, you know, not put it off for later. And so, you know, this diagram shows that there's a way to lower activation energy by something called a catalyst. Now, we know of catalysts in chemical reactions, but we also know of them as sort of the analogy of something that gets people going or gets a movement going. And so we have to find catalysts for what's going to accelerate us, what's going to get us going when things feel like we're facing a wall. A lot of my patients will tell me that it's not necessarily a task, it's a getting out and meeting up with people. Oh God, I know I should, but I just don't have the energy to get my clothes on, go take a shower, do my hair, blah, blah, blah. But then once they've gone out, oh my God, I had such a great time. I'm so glad I came. You know, so that's a really important thing of just sort of figuring out what is the way to lower that activation energy and get that catalyst going. So some ideas. Now, this is going back to this hedge analogy, the trimming the hedge. Well, break each task down into smaller bites. So, okay, I don't think about trimming the hedge. Just think about, I need to find my gardening boots. Okay, got my gardening boots. Okay, now I need to find my gardening gloves. Okay, I got those. Now I need to find my shears. Okay, I got those. Another way to do it is to make sure you're doing it at a time of day that works for your medications. Make sure that the medications are working well when you're going to go out to do that. Another important thing that's important with getting, sorry, I said important twice. Another thing that can be helpful to getting started is to set a calendar or set a reminder or set a schedule. In this case, they've sort of suggested that you've got an egg timer. You're going to do something every 15 minutes. That might be a little too much pressure. I would say more like, you know, put it on your calendar. You know, Wednesday morning, trim two of the hedges. You know, you don't even have to commit to trimming all of the hedges. You're just going to do two of them, something like that. And another a detour that's depicted here is the person calls in somebody to kind of help get them started or helps, you know, show them how to do it in a way where it's like, okay, and you may think of it as you're going to show me what to do, but also sort of like teamwork, sort of this a little bit more fun to do things together. And oh, right. Okay. I get it. Now I can go on from there. So, and of course, you know, certain things may need to be outsourced. We may need to prioritize, you know what? It's not important in my life to be the one who trims the hedges. Let me hire somebody to do that. Let me use my energy and my time to do something more fun. You know, so those are the kinds of things where you kind of have to pick and choose and prioritize what's important as well. Oh yes. Now, for the care partner, what may they consider? You know, they may need to find ways to simplify tasks for the person with Parkinson's. They may need to filter things in a way. They may need to offer more narrow choices. You know, if somebody's struggling with problems getting dressed because they're like, oh gosh, I just don't even know what to wear. Well, here's a couple of shirts. Which one do you want to choose from these two? Might be easier than opening the closet and sort of feeling daunted by that. Often it's important to just give people a little bit more space and time. Interestingly, with Parkinson's, sometimes when people are rushed, they're actually slower. So by giving people more time, they may actually move faster. So that's an important piece of it. Take, you know, give yourself more time to get ready in the mornings, you know, if that's possible. And then what I wrote down at the bottom, call in an external authority, is especially for the exercise analogy, I find a lot of people, and you know, myself included, like it's hard to motivate yourself to get to the gym or to, you know, go out for the walk or whatever. But, you know, if the neighbor comes by and says, hey, I'm going for a walk, you should come with me, you know, that can often, that sort of external authority, or you've got the personal trainer telling you what to do. Now, all of a sudden, you can go longer, go farther, do more complicated things because somebody else is sort of guiding that motivation. And it isn't just motivation, it's just also that fun element of it as well. Fun is very important. So forgetting future intentions. So like, what did I come into this room for? Or like, oh, I was supposed to call the doctor and I forgot I was supposed to do that. I was supposed to show up for this appointment. I forgot about that. Medications are hard to take every day, on time, all the time. Forgetting to turn off the stove. These are things that, again, can happen to a lot of us, but are more concerning or more common or more problematic in people with Parkinson's. So how can we deal with this? Well, sometimes it helps to set an alarm, for example, for medications. I like to recommend people to use it as a, rather than a reminder, at least, again, I'm not Samsung knowledgeable, I'm iOS, Apple device. In Apple, there's reminders and there's alarms. And if it's a reminder, it sort of like blips up on your phone and it's very easy to ignore. But an alarm, yes, you can ignore it, but you can set it to like as a snooze, like, okay, I don't need to be reminded about this right now, but it'll come back in 9 minutes. Hey, did you take your medication? So that's how I would do it so that it's less, it's more difficult to ignore. One thing that I always like to recommend is writing things down immediately. For me, what I do is I use my dictate feature on my phone to set reminders and to add things to a shopping list. Again, specifically on the Apple device, you can actually call it a shopping list, which is different, you know, so it's all in one spot so that it's not like you have different reminders all over the place that are hard to find. You can remind yourself to do something at a specific time. You know, remind me to call the doctor's office at 3 p.m. tomorrow, you know, remind me to get gas on my way home. Or to charge my car when I get home, as the case may be. Another key point is doing things one at a time. So, you know, if you're trying to remember, you know, something and you're in the middle of something else, it may be difficult to do that. For the care partner, it may be important to pick your battles, learn what to let go of. You know, it may be important to give space and time. Sometimes that person with Parkinson's may find their own detour if they sort of are just given a little bit of time to do things. And, you know, it's okay to sort of ask it kind of in a non-judgmental way, in a neutral way. You know, did you take your medications? Or, hey, remember to take your medications. And again, often when it's, you know, coming from love, it can be more, you know, benign as far as how it's accepted when people are given reminders. You know, often even framing it as like, I know I forget things sometimes, so maybe you can remind me when I'm forgetting as well. So, you know, we can remind each other. Actually, there's evidence behind this that couples actually, you know, kind of like almost like share a brain a little bit, that there's sort of this like space between people's brains of shared experiences and shared memories that it really helps to have two people. And that also, you know, similarly, in terms of, you know, remembering what has been said in a doctor's office, there's evidence that, you know, even people with no memory problems whatsoever will forget about 25% of what's said at the doctor's office. So having somebody come with you so that there's two sets of ears of, okay, wait, the doctor said I need to, you know, make this appointment, call this person for this referral, etc., that two people are listening, that can really help. So multitasking. A lot of my patients are very troubled by their perceived difficulties with multitasking. But in reality, multitasking was always an illusion. Nobody is really multitasking. I have definitely seen people who are having struggles with this. But the reality is that whatever we're doing one thing consciously, and the other things we're doing subconsciously. So for example, if I'm having a conversation with you while doing the dishes, I'm doing the dishes subconsciously. I'm kind of on autopilot and I'm talking to you consciously. Sometimes I might be shifting gears, or as we call it, set shifting, very rapidly. So I'm having a conversation with you, my phone blips, I turn my concentration to the phone, come back to you. And I've done that quickly enough where it might seem seamless, but that can get difficult with people with Parkinson's. So both that autopilot and the set shifting. So how do we cope with this? Again, taking things one step at a time, doing one task at a time, slowing down and focusing on the more important task can be important. And again, for the care partner, it can be very important to wait for that person with Parkinson's to finish doing one thing before addressing second task. And I would say this is true even for people who don't have Parkinson's. You know, if I'm having a conversation with my spouse, I have to wait for him to be done before I can sort of look him in the eyes, see if he's ready to hear what I have to say. Otherwise, I'm pretty much wasting my breath. So executive function, very common symptom that's affected by Parkinson's. Often people won't have a memory problem, or they won't perceive a memory problem there, but they, upon asking, they'll notice, or their family member will notice, that they've struggled a bit with executive function, planning, coordinating, organizing, keeping track of the steps to go. The analogy that was given here, the example that was given in the book was cooking, but there's other things too, like planning a trip, crafting, you know, having a dinner party. There's probably 100 steps that were involved with that event, or more, maybe 1,000, depending on how you break them down. So that can be difficult with sort of knowing where am I and what do I need to do next, and what was I doing concurrently, and what do I need to turn on and off, etc. So let's use the cooking analogy. Example. So very helpful to prepare. Lay out the ingredients in advance. Write out parts of the recipe into smaller steps. I find a lot of recipes will sort of sneak the steps into the ingredients. Like, you know, you have nuts, but they were supposed to be toasted, cooled, and then chopped. And, you know, if you miss that part, you know, you're in the middle of the recipe and now it's time to add the nuts. And it's like, oh, wait a minute. Now I have to go back and do that. Now I've kind of gone out of order. So rereading the recipe, making sure that every part is actually broken out into smaller steps might sometimes be helpful, or draw little diagrams or that kind of thing. Make space, avoid distraction, cook only when there's no pressure or tension, take your time. These are things that are important. You know, it might be important to simplify, choose easier or more familiar recipes. I think it's always great to use pre-cut veggies or things that sort of accelerate that recipe. Like, you know, you don't need to stand there and hollow out a butternut squash and take the skin off and all of that. You can buy it pre-cut for you, and then it's ready to go. You often may need to reread the recipe, visualize it, and use checklists. Again, checklists are things that are designed, you know, for all of us with human brains. You know, this is not specific to Parkinson's. You know, using checklists to in surgery, using checklists to fly planes safely. So the same goes with, you know, the shopping list and the cooking. You know, put a little checkbox next to everything and make sure that it's done. Involving others, cooking with a family member, having a sous chef, as it were. Have a potluck, ask people to bring a dish, so that in that sense, you don't stop entertaining, or you don't stop having people over. But instead of making three courses, you may say, you know, I'll make a, you know, could you make a salad, please? You know, could you pick up, you know, something on your way, et cetera. And sometimes we need to, again, outsource, let somebody else cook. Again, this idea of, is it really that priority? Is it really important? It doesn't have to be all the time, that kind of thing. That I meant to delete that slide. Apologies, apologies for that. So let's talk about communication. And I'm going to take a sip so that I can continue with my voice. Hang on for a sec. Thank you. So people with Parkinson's can often experience a softening of their voice in the volume as well as in the clarity, like they might slur their speech, or they might use the word stutter. They may struggle with the beginning of the word. Sometimes people, I find, especially people who are on treatment for Parkinson's, they may actually have a faster speech, but they've gone too fast. And now they're slurring because their voice is too fast. That's called tachypnea. Often facial expression. Oh, and by the way, what I should say about the voice is about half the time that somebody has a voice issue, I find they're either not noticing it or not bothered by it. And that it's more of an issue for those around them than the patient with Parkinson's is actually expressing for themselves as a problem. Like they're not prioritizing it as a problem. They're not hearing it as a problem. Whereas other people are saying, you know, I'm having a really hard time hearing you. Nonverbal communication, very important. Facial expressivity can be reduced. We know that as masked faces, but that can be part of how not only we communicate, but also, you know, the perception of that emotional part of that conversation. You know, if people's family members are feeling like, you know, the patient is distant or not as interested, it may just be that their face is not registering the interest that they have. Thinking obstacles, of course, as we mentioned before, word finding difficulties, as an example, can affect communication. Fatigue can play a role. Person might do very well, but for shorter conversations, or time of day might matter. I was talking to somebody who, you know, somebody called them at 9 p.m. at night, and she really wanted to talk to this person. So she had a conversation, and by the an hour went by, and it was not pretty. So, you know, sometimes it's a matter of saying, you know what, I really do want to talk to you, but can we set a time to talk tomorrow around noon? I'll be in a better space then. That's an important detour that can be used. Self-image can play a role here, especially when it comes to having a conversation in a larger group and feeling more withdrawn and pulling back from that conversation. So having that confidence to, you know, continue with that conversation is a very important piece of it. And again, my thought is with these detours is understanding that, you know, it's okay if we are using that or sort of verbalizing that, you know, I do want to be part of this conversation, but I'm going to ask you guys to speak one at a time so I can stay in this conversation, or I'm going to ask everybody to, you know, turn down the music so that I can stay in this group conversation, things like that. People may need to feel, often will need to feel comfortable with their conversation partner. So they may do better with somebody they're familiar with than with a stranger. As I mentioned before, emotional state, mindset, this matters. This matters for all of it, right? It sort of percolates through. And then of course, hearing issues. So that goes on the part of the person with Parkinson's as well as the people around them. Often I found the person with Parkinson's is accusing the other person of not hearing because it's a hearing issue on their end. But people with hearing issues can get more withdrawn in a conversation because they're not hearing what's being said and they might isolate more. And that's not good for the brain. That actually is associated with the subsequent risk of developing dementia. So I do emphasize people to really push on, you know, getting seen by an audiologist, getting a hearing test done. So management, how do we cope with these things? So we have two excellent speech therapists within our group, and other places around town, excellent speech therapists, work on expiratory muscle strength training can be helpful, bringing conscious attention to the voice. For the care partner, the power of mirroring can be important. So if we sort of smile a little bit more broadly, or kind of almost laugh if something is humorous or kind of pleasant, that might pull out more of a smile in the person with Parkinson's. Again, keeping it short is important, taking a break, giving pauses. For the person with Parkinson's, they may need to learn to adjust their own pace and talk more slowly, but that's true also of the people that they're talking with as well. That may need to happen in a respectful way, of course. As I mentioned before, if possible, it's better to avoid putting words in the person's mouth, but if they request it, then of course we can provide that. So let's move on to some games and apps that can help sort of jog the cognitive function in a number of different ways. So one element is memory apps. You know, I mentioned those that are built in already, the reminders app, the alarms that you can, oh, by the way, you can name the alarms and you can set the alarms to recur, you know, and it could say 3 p.m. medicine and you can repeat it every day. But some people like some of these apps that kind of combine things in a different way. So one of them is called Cue Card. Again, with medications, there's some people who prefer an app-based way to do that, like Pillboxy or Dosecast. And then there are cognitive games that can be found on the App Store. The one I like to recommend is called Clock Yourself. This is a way to get cognitive and physical dual tasking, meaning doing two tasks at the same time to improve. But so the person is standing in the middle of an imaginary clock and they are listening to the app call out a number from 1 through 12. If the app calls out the number 3, they will step with their right foot to the right, and then they will come back to the center. If the app calls out the number 11, they will use their left foot to step mostly to the front, a little bit to the left. Again, visualizing themselves in the center of the clock. Clock Yourself can be very simple, or it can be made more difficult physically by increasing the speed, by using weights, by using a tap as they're going, or even a jump if the balance is okay. And it can be made more difficult cognitively by changing the numbers from 1 through 12 to the minutes, 5 through 60, or change the from numbers to months of the year. So for example, if it calls out March, the person would move their right foot to the right for the number 3, essentially. It can be done in Spanish or Mandarin or a number of other languages. It can be done with visual icons that need to be memorized. So it can be quite challenging cognitively, but it's a nice app that really can help any level. A lot of my patients are really enjoying word games. Wordle can be very fun because it's done with a group and it's a single puzzle every day. Most people are familiar with Wordle, and Words with Friends is basically online Scrabble that you can play with your friends kind of at any time. Like it doesn't have to be one game at a time. It can sort of be spread out. And I also like Connections. There's a slightly easier version called Red Herring, where it can be adjusted to easy, normal, or hard mode. Connections, the concept is that you have to sort of come up with how these words are connected to each other. And they try to kind of throw you off by putting words together that are, well, maybe that's one connection. Are we there yet? But in reality, those are not the connections. One of the connections in this example is R, U, C, and Y are all words that are also letters. So that one's really fun, but can be quite challenging at times. And then Wordscapes is essentially anagrams. It's basically, not so much anagrams, but making words out of a number of letters. Wordscapes is done in a way where you get a little bit of a hint because it's done like a crossword puzzle. One thing I would caution about these kinds of things is don't spend too much time, like crossword puzzles, word searches, don't spend too much time on it. One of the things I like about Wordle is that it's one per day and then you're done, or the connection, same thing. It's one a day so that you have a little bit of that, jazzing your, cognitive and language skills, but you're not stuck there doing it for hours. And the reason I say that is because I think it's much more important to be physically active and to socially engage and have that cognitive stimulation, be connected to something social, than just to sit and do, you know, the word game or the app for hours on end. So this is all about dosing it, you know, that I think is important. So brain training, brain HQ has been shown in people with Parkinson's to improve attention and processing speed. Those who were doing brain HQ showed less decline on memory compared to the controlled group, which didn't get any training. I think that that's an option. Again, Lumosity, Elevate, and Peak are also options. Don't spend too much time on it, but just sort of like a little dose of brain training might be helpful. So when to call in for support, or when to turn to, you know, the authorities to help, as it were. So, obviously asking for speech therapy, we're always happy to refer to anybody, really. Speech therapists can do cognitive therapy, so they can sort of help guide people on how to use these games, these apps, these skills, et cetera. Sometimes the question may be adjusting the medication, both the Parkinson's medication like carbidopa-levodopa. Sometimes if the issue is cognitive decline to the point where things have become problematic, there may be cognitive medications that are given, like Exelon or rivastigmine is FDA approved for Parkinson's related cognitive symptoms. People with depression and anxiety, where it's really gone above and beyond sort of the normal levels of stress and kind of anxiety, where really things have become kind of out of hand or very limiting because of those mood symptoms, might need therapy or medication or other treatments for those symptoms. Working with a psychologist, the therapist, psychiatrist, and often a marital counselor, because sometimes what things come down to communication wise is, you know, the things that, you know, most of us have not learned of, you know, what the best ways are to communicate with our spouses. Support groups can be really helpful, especially care partner support groups. And again, we do have that here at PNI, especially for the care partners. As I mentioned, connecting with an audiologist for people who have struggled with their hearing aids, again, connecting back with the audiologist, figuring out what the best option is for that. Using spiritual and cultural community support is important. A lot of people do well with music and singing, and mindful awareness and meditation can be really important. And again, even it's literally just one breath can make a difference. Okay, what was that word I was thinking of? Or, okay, how am I going to find my way home from here? You know, literally or figuratively. Here at PNI, with our foundation support, we have lifestyle programs where we have memory classes that can be helpful as well. Final thoughts. So, heard this recently, and I couldn't remember where I heard it, but apparently it's attributed to somebody named Marcy. So sort of was written by, you know, this idea of a person who was writing for, you know, the lay public for self-actualization and goal setting and things like that. But I find that, oh my goodness, this seems so apt for people with Parkinson's. Intention, attention, no tension. So the first is, of course, set an attention, set a goal. You know, if things are sort of lax, I should get around to trimming the hedges. You know, it's kind of like it might not happen, right? An attention would be, I have an hour today that's what I'm planning on doing. That is the goal. I'm going to trim these hedges today. Or even if it's two of them, I'm going to get to two of them. Attention means focus, you know, stay on that task, break that task down to smaller pieces if necessary, but really be focused on that at each time. And then no tension is, you know, stress reduction, mindful awareness, you know, doing things in a way where I don't have to worry about getting this done immediately, I'm not being put on the spot. I'm in a good space mentally to do this, that kind of idea. And none of this is easy. That's one thing. You know, nobody ever said this was going to be easy. That's why I said, I didn't say fast lane. I said detours. So it's important to acknowledge that, yes, this is a difficult situation, but, you know, there people can reach their goals and they can find that quality of life that, you know, is important to them. So I'm going to end there and see if there's any questions for me.
We have no questions in the chat, Dr. Petrossian. Thank you so much. I think that was this is definitely a talk that we all need. And it's great to end the year with this talk because it really points us to the fact that, you know, with the Parkinson's, it's not really just the motor symptoms. And it takes a whole village. It takes a team to take care of our symptoms. And it's not necessarily the hardest part may not necessarily just be the motor symptoms, but the basic of things of like communicating our needs and structuring it in a way where we are able to manage them and they're not overwhelming. And sometimes that we need a whole team to do that, not just your providers or your family, but you need probably like a therapist too, because sometimes, you know, our life did not come with a manual, and sometimes we need ways to learn to communicate, even if we have been with loved ones for quite a time. But certainly I really love the final thoughts of the intentions, attention, and no tension. I think that
had you heard that one before, Giselle?
No, that was really great. I love that because it's very specific. It's this very short words, but it's very clear of what we need to do. Like, what is the intention to be able to do this?
I feel like it's a good mantra. You could like say it to yourself when you wake up in the morning, or you can, you know, scrawl it on with like a dry erase on your bathroom mirror, you know, like intention, attention, no tension. Like, what am I doing? You know, what's on my list for today, you know, or this week or this year or whatever, you know. I think, let's not say year, let's say this month, you know, I thought it was really cool.
And it can be very specific. I think that's what I like about it, because you can be very specific in your intention of getting through this week or finishing one aspect, and then giving the attention would be to maybe I'm going to give this attention for 20 minutes. I'm going to do everything on this list. So it's very specific. And actually, it results in no tension too, if you think about it.
Right.
If you're clear and you cut it into bite-sized pieces, so to speak.
Yeah.
There are no questions on the chat or in the Q&A, Dr. P, but there were people that were certainly late. So I just wanted to reiterate that we are changing the schedule for the Everything Parkinson's webinar. We're going to be doing it every other month now. So we will not have an Everything Parkinson's webinar in January. We're going to have it in February. It's going to be the same time at 12 noon to 1 p.m. And for those that have missed prior episodes, you certainly can go to the PNI website. We do record all the webinars if you want to just refresh, get a fresh take of the previous ones and want to rewatch them. You certainly can do so. We've had 2 years already of webinar episodes, so there is a lot of videos.
Oh yeah, three years.
Is it three already? You're right.
December 2020.
Oh my goodness! Yes, you're right. 3 years. So that's a lot. That's over
like 30 our 3 year anniversary, Giselle. Like
yes, December, we started in December. I
started with Dr. Diaz December 7, 2020.
How perfect is that? So we've talked about so many things over the years. So make sure to rewatch some of the videos. There are certainly about the motor symptoms of Parkinson's, definitely a lot of lifestyle. There are specific to those that are exercise, nutrition. a lot of also emotional support, ways to deal with loved ones, caregivers, having those difficult conversations. We all certainly have those in the website, and it would be good to rewatch some of those. So certainly, if there is no questions.
Well, I just wanted to say one more thing. Just want to, once again, as I've said before, if you guys have thoughts about what you'd like us to talk about, please send an email to, Giselle or myself, or you can email our front desk and they'll forward it to us. There are a lot of old ones on our website that is through pacificneuro.org. You can go to resources and then webinars. So we're trying not to repeat ourselves, but we've had a lot, 3 years of very specific topics. And again, just like Giselle said, some things are not really relevant to everybody. And so going back into, what those older talks are might be helpful.
Certainly. So thank you everyone for being here with us over the last 3 years. We hope that you will always remember us when you think about getting good information regarding Parkinson's disease. Thank you for making us part of your Mondays. And like I said, you certainly can go back to those videos. Have a wonderful rest of 2023. And we will see you back February 2024. Take care, everyone. Thank you so much, Dr. Petrossian.
Thank you, Giselle. Happy holidays.
Happy holidays.